Hey, Adila, how are you? T. Davis, how are you? I'm well, Adela. Thank you. I'm well. Thank you. Let's give the stragglers a little time to come on in. Hey, Deacon Dunlap. All right. I'm going to have to move forward. I can't wait that long. I'm grateful tonight to be here. Grateful for you. Grateful to be alive, most of all alive in Christ. Grateful for this profound opportunity I have to share my labor of love. Grateful for you, who did count it not robbery, to come in and share with us in this evening's Bible study. Good evening, Wanda McClure. Pray with me. God, we thank you so much for your faithfulness, your consistency, your love towards us, even while we were yet sinners, you died for us. Thank you for your promises, which are true. It's our prayer that your presence will be with us. Open our minds and spirits that we might hear what it is your spirit has to say to the church. We love and thank you for having chosen us out of darkness. Now teach us how to represent your light. God, I love you and I thank you. I honor and I adore you. Forgive me for my sins of omission and commission, as I know I've fallen short today. This is your servant's prayer. Receive now in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We have a light number tonight, but I'm gonna go on. Just like and share, like and share. You know, tonight we're gonna go right into this this spirit of forgiveness thing, but I wanna context this with last week's lesson, simply because last week's lesson is the feeder to this week's lesson. Last week's lesson, we dealt with the consciousness and the duty of us to draw near to God. After we draw near to God with a true heart, a true conscience, being thankful that we are guaranteed full assurance of this faith walk or this faith relationship that we have with God. And this full assurance means unqualified assurance in Christ that he is the one and that he'll do what he said he'll do. Then secondly, we must have hearts and bodies that are perfectly cleansed and washed, that our what we do for Christ must be of a pure heart. The point is this: before we approach God, we must be cleansed of sin and its guilt. We must be cleansed by the blood of Christ, and we have to approach God through Jesus Christ. And Christ alone is the perfect sacrifice for all of our sins. It's through Christ that we gain access to our righteousness. It's through Christ that we gain access to the promises. It's through Christ that we gain access to the gifts and talents that God has in store for us. Then we moved on to confession. We said that the second duty was to hold fast to our profession of faith without wavering. A person who makes a true profession in Christ believes two things, that Christ is the Savior and that he's the perfect sacrifice, that Christ is the risen Lord, and that Christ is the high priest who is seated at the right hand of the Father making intercessions for you and me. And when a person professes Christ to be the Savior and Lord, he is to hold this profession fast without wavering. What that means, y'all, in the midst of adversities or the midst of struggles, in the midst of setbacks, in the midst of challenges, that's when we hold fast to Christ even the more. I think most of us, when we get into a challenging space that we've never been in for, that's uncomfortable, the first thing we do is denounce Christ and then go start trying to give him advice. When most of our circumstances are of a spiritual nature, most of what's going wrong in my life is of a spiritual nature. I've found through the years that when I straighten out the spirit man, my life kind of falls in order. I don't care what it is, whether it's overweight, whether it's my mindset, whether it's my spirit, whatever it is. When I straighten out my spirit man, my life falls in order. So this profession of our faith without wavering is essential. It's one of the most important things after we've reached for God, we've confessed our faith, we're consciously in the game, and that's what is required of this walk. But what happens is the believer is listening to voices in the world and people outside. Materialism gets our mindset trapped and the bag gets us trapped. But the believer is to trust God in all things. The third duty is to stir up one another. You know, if you're not stirred up, you can't stir up anybody else. To stir one another to love and do good works. Listen, it means to give attention to one another, to fix our attention, be consciously aware and give continuous care, to watch over, to exhort, to help the believer to grow and be like you think you are. You know, what's interesting is that when we grow in Christ, we'll then become a multiplier of disciples. When we ourselves grow in Christ, we are then to become a multiplier of disciples. That means we are to then encourage others to share the information that we have that's transforming our lives, because we've never arrived. But we transform. Hey, good evening, Deacon. We transform to the extent that we can be used by God. I want all of y'all to like and share. Let's start liking and sharing. Like and share. So the whole thing is that this third duty is that we're to give attention to one another, that to fix our attention on one another, to continuously care for one another, and to watch over our. Our church covenant says to stir up each other unto every good word and work, to watch each other and to not needlessly expose the infirmities of others. So it means to really just care for one another like you would care for yourself. It means that we love in action, not in just word, that we feed the poor, we visit the sick, we tend to the sick and shut up. Note the exhortation again. We give attention to one another. Why? To make sure none of us is slacking up. You know, the challenge today is people don't like to be confronted about what's wrong in their life. People don't like to be confronted. But as Christians, that's our challenge. It's not a judgment call. It's a call to keep you on the road, to keep you focused. And sometimes it takes a situation and a person to see that it's going wrong to help me to get back on course. I know my brothers, my preacher friends, my people who know me, they know when I'm off track, and they'll say some slick stuff out their mouth that better refocus my attention. And then the fourth and final thing in this act prior to getting to where we are today is worship. The fourth duty is to assemble together, to never forsake the assembly. What a night to share this when we saw lower numbers on Bible study. Don't forsake the assembly. You know, one thing about growth is it requires a zeal for knowledge. Growth requires a zeal. You got to hunger and thirst after God's righteousness. And if you hunger and thirst, God will feed you. Feed you what? His word. And his word fuels our life and changes our actions. See, y'all, you have to fuel yourself on the word of God. You have to feed yourself on the word of God. Good evening, Alicia. Always good to see you, my daughter. So listen, listen very closely. Worship, prayer, study of God's word, and doing ministry. But all of that comes as a result of conscious confession, walking in God, allowing, look, seeking God's face, allowing God to use you. And no, everybody don't have the same gifts, but whatever your gift is, be glad to be a part of it. Be consciously aware that God gave it to you, not for you to glamour in, but the gifts are for the perfecting of the saints, for the edifying of the body of Christ, so we all come to the unity. So it's our job then to get the gift, to get what God has for us, and to consciously be in the game with God, consciously share the story, consciously be available to God, consciously be used by God. Good evening, Rashida. Read this verse closely, and it clearly seems that the idea is often that we are to assemble together often and never forsake coming together. Genuine believers need each other. We need the presence, the fellowship, the strength. There's strength in numbers, the encouragement. And in that group, there's care and there's love for one another. You know, that's a lot of places are now networking centers. And that's fine if the purpose for which we network is the development of the kingdom. That's okay to belong to a place where they're networking. If the networking is for the purpose of doing kingdom building business, not for the purpose of selfish gain or development. Now, I wanted to share that because I thought it was interesting how Paul outlines this whole Corinthians text with respect to our challenges and initiates this whole thing with consciousness, moves on from consciousness to being faithful, moves on from faithfulness to having a profession of faithfulness. What that means is let your yea be yea, your nay be nay. If you say you're doing that, then let's do that. If you say you serve Christ, then serve Christ. Let your profession and your behavior be moving in the same direction. Then Paul says that if we do those things on the horizontal, on the vertical, horizontally, we can get along with our brother. Horizontally, we'll know how to stir each other up into every good word and work. Horizontally, we'll know how to encourage each other in times of fall. The horizontal and vertical, right? So important that this relationship is together before we try to get these relationships together. These relationships won't work if these relationships are not together. If vertically we're not connected with God, then horizontally, we're going to have some challenges. We're going to have some challenges with people. We're going to have some challenges with our faith. We're going to have challenges with our frustrations. And that's because we don't trust the process, family. We have to must trust the process. Good evening, Dr. McKnight. Let's move fastly to what our lesson is really about. That was the introduction to the lesson tonight. To the lesson tonight, we're dealing with this 18th chapter, verse 21 through 35. And it reads, share with me as I read out loud. Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to 70 times. Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to 70 times, but up to 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain man who wanted to settle accounts with his servant. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one of them brought to him who owed 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and his children and all that he had, that payments before were made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I'll pay you. Then the master of the servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him his debt. But that servant, on one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, "Pay me what you owe." So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you all." And he would not, but he went through him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Listen. I could talk about this without even, that's interesting. And that's a good segue into the reality of forgiveness. There's five pivotal moves that this text makes. Within the context of those five moves, in verse 21 and 22, we see that the spirit and practice of forgiveness. In verses 23 through 27, there is God's spirit of forgiveness, like a king who takes account of his servants. Then in verses 28 through 31, there's the servant's spirit of unforgiveness. And then in verses 32 through 34, there's the great day of accounting. Now, forgiveness is what it's all about. But it's hard to forgive if you're not consciously aware how good God is to you. If you're not consciously aware how God forgives us daily. I think we want people to be something that they're incapable of being. But the reality is unforgiveness has nothing to do with external factors. That's what my heart is dealing with, not what the person has done. Because people have done some hideous things to me that initially I would attack. But now I respond differently. And my rewards are differently. My peace level is different. Because I'm consciously aware of my own behavior, not other people's behavior. When I'm watching your behavior, it don't give me a time to assess my responsibility in the situation that created the fallout. But there's no situation, watch this, common to man that God won't deliver. So there's no situation common to us that we shouldn't forgive. Here's the thing, though. When we forgive people, that don't mean we have to invite them back into that space. That means we just forgive them and move on. We don't let them live rent free with us in our head. Because when you don't forgive somebody, it develops a resentment. And what a resentment does is you repeat the same thing over and over. So whatever that person did to initiate what caused you pain, until you forgive them, it's a repetitive sense. They're doing it to you over and over and over again. So it's so important to just let people off the hook. You know, for example, if you were abused, which is, you know, by somebody, I'm not saying that what they did was right, but I'm saying you forgive them so you can move on with your life. You forgive them so you can move on with your life. I forgive, hey, my daughter, hey, sweetie, hey, Gloria, my daughter, good to see my daughter always. So listen, and my granddaughter, hey, baby, I know my baby on there, yeah. So there is the spirit of practice of forgiveness. See, but listen, remember what I said, the practice of the spirit of forgiveness. You got to really practice forgiveness. Note exactly what happened between Peter and Jesus. Peter asked about forgiving a brother. Is forgiving limited? Peter's concern was forgiving another Christian brother, a fellow disciple. Christ also placed a discussion in the context of kingdom of heaven. That is the Christian community or the church. So Peter was very generous in his concept of forgiveness. To forgive a person 7 times for having wronged oneself is very generous, right? Far more generous than what most people do. Right? But Jesus answered that forgiveness is unlimited. Somebody say, ouch. And I want y'all to like and share. Like and share. Somebody say, ouch. Jesus answered that forgiveness is unlimited. Wow. Jesus then illustrated the spirit of forgiveness by referring to the kingdom of heaven. He says the kingdom of heaven in its present form includes some people who are servants of God, but they are servants in profession only. Huh? The servant in this parable professes faith in God, but his profession is false. He's in the church walking among God's people in a desperate moment of dire need. God has met him and offered him mercy and forgiveness, but he has not personally learned anything about God's compassion and forgiveness. You know, we want mercy when mercy suits our case. We want justice when justice suits our case. We want to be forgiven when we wrong. Y'all, you got to do the same thing to others. I ain't talking about the golden rule. I'm talking about what Christ said. We got to forgive one another. And, you know, I found out the more I forgive other people, the better I feel about me. Because if I can't do nothing to change people, I can only change me. You know, when people forgive you, you know, they don't have to bring you back in the camp, but you let them off the hook. Listen, let's look at a deeper study of this word forgiveness. I did you a favor. Listen, so forgiveness really is talking about relationships, bonding, brotherhood, unity, right? Hey, Miss Valerie, I know you're right, Miss Valerie, and we have to all the time. You know, Miss Valerie, as we mature as Christians, things come up that we didn't even know were creating stink for us, or that were holding us in bondage. And unforgiveness only holds me in bondage. And because I forgive a person, I don't mean I got to bring them back in. I just need to forgive them and move on with my life and not go and tell everybody about it. So listen to, this is a deeper look. 70 times 7 is 490. But this is not the point Jesus is making. The question is, how often should we forgive a brother? Listen, Peter says till 7 times. Jesus says no, until 70 times 7. What Jesus meant is 70 times 7 times 70 times 7, on and on until eternity. Because you don't know how your forgiveness might affect the recovery or restoration of another person. You don't know how what they did to you may affect them until it becomes an issue that we talk about and deal with as maturing adults. And then once I forgive, not only am I off the hook, but I'm releasing somebody else to grow and mature also. Y'all, this whole walk we in is really about growing up. It's hard to grow up when you think you grow. You know why? Because growing up requires hearing other people's opinion of what you're doing or listening to something outside of yourself. If all of your advice is coming from you, then you're getting advice from a fool. If all your advice is coming from you, then you're getting advice from an idiot. So what Jesus meant was over and over and over and over. Forgiveness is a matter of the heart, not of the mind. The mind will only keep a record of wrongs. A spirit of forgiveness does not measure and limit the number of times that you forgive. A spirit of forgiveness will tolerate being wrong and hurt time after time after time. Wow, some Christians need to hear this. Because Christians are the meanest people in the world. Just mean for no reason. Won't forgive nobody. But they want God to forgive them. Right? Want God to forgive us. So listen, there are several reasons why the spirit of forgiveness knows no limit, no measure, no number, no times that it forgives. Excuse me, family. Listen, forgiveness is a thing of the spirit. A quality of the spirit, an attribute of the spirit. All spiritual things, substances, and realities such as love and mercy and grace and joy and forgiveness cannot be measured or limited. Let me say that again. Glory to God. Watch these, because these are attributes of God, so we can't limit them. Watch this. Such love and mercy and grace. We all want love over and over again from God. We all want mercy over and over again from God. We all want grace over and over again from God. We all want joy and forgiveness. But are you willing to insert that? That's right, Miss Valerie. You got to be able to give what you want for yourself. So listen, they are by their very nature spiritual and not physical. Y'all, love is spiritual, mercy is spiritual, grace is spiritual, joy is spiritual, all which are attributes of the relationship I have with Christ that are gifts of the Spirit. Where Christ says, I will not leave you comfortless, I will leave you another help of the Holy Spirit who would bring back to your remembrance all those things I've taught you. So the more I know about Christ, the more I'm able to do of Christ. But you know what? I've named this entire series Repetition Builds Strength, because you got to do it over and over and over and over again. You don't do it once and think you got it. You got to continue in this process like sin. If you continue in sin, it'll become an addiction. So have you thought about what would happen if you continue doing the work, the grace gift of Christ gives? You become more like him. See, y'all, that's how we become about Christ. Not going to church, not talking about the Bible, but being about it. You can say a lot of stuff about a lot of about me, but I'm going to do the will of God. You know why? Because I like the way it makes me feel, and I'm addicted to good feeling. So I do it. And not only that, I've been doing it long enough to know the benefits of it. So listen, we are to experience and practice love at every opportunity. And all forgiveness is an act of love. Huh? That's why Jesus draws a line in the sand. Let he who is without sin cast the first stone. Absolutely. Practice as doctors do. I love it, Miss Valerie. We are to experience and practice forgiveness at every opportunity. Forgiveness is a reality of the Spirit. Therefore, it is to be a spirit of life. That's what I said earlier. When you forgive somebody, it really pumps life back into their situation, especially somebody who's godly sorry for what they did. Everybody ain't godly sorry. Some people, that's just who I am. No, that's who you've become, because who we are and made in the image of God. So all of these bad attributes that come out of us don't have nothing to do with who we are. It's what we become as a form of protection. You know, it's a form of protection. So therefore, it is to be a spirit of life. The spirit of forgiveness is to forgive 70 times 70 ad infinitum, ad infinitum, ad infinitum. And that means on and on and on. So good human relationships are impossible without a forgiving spirit. You know, when I marry people, the first thing I ask them, what are the deal breakers? And they start telling you what the deal breakers is. And I tell them, well, the deal is already broke. Because if you come in with preconceived notions about what you leave about, then you're setting yourself up. You got to go in with tabula rasa, a blank slate, and allow God's spirit to influence the covenantal relationship that you're about to sign. Good human relationships are impossible without a forgiving spirit. Offending others is common to all. Okay? We are all sinful. And we all offend. Some just offend more often. Some just offend without conscience. Some just offend and don't care. What I'm saying to you is that when you and I are offended, we have to forgive the offender. And I'm going to say it over and over so people don't think I'm crazy. That don't mean you give them a chance to do it again. That means you just don't, you let them off the hook. You don't let them live rent-free in your head. No one walks perfectly or anywhere close to where they want you to think they are. Ain't none of us as good as we want you to think we are. That's why we dress up the outside so well when we come to church, because we want this to give a reflection on what we want people to think is really happening in here. And but what happens in here ultimately comes out of here and your movement. We ain't got to ask nobody nothing. Just watch what they do. What you do speak so loud, what you say don't matter. You know, and when you are in a situation where you've forgiven people over and over for the same thing, that's when you got to move on, because they're not concerned about how you feel about a certain thing. They're not concerned. Or they've been doing it long enough that they become comfortable and they think that that's right, regardless of what you believe. That's why I say any person convinced against their own will is of the same opinion still. Okay? So if we kept score, there would be little time to do anything else for all the pain that we've been caused. If we kept score for all of the people we think owe us forgiveness and we owe forgiveness, we wouldn't have enough time in the day. To keep all relationships healthy, we need to know at least four things, right? Coming short, sinning, falling, and offending are common to us all. None of us are different. We all offend by failing to smile. You ever, you know, one of the greatest challenges I have is when somebody, you know, you let somebody over in traffic, or, you know, just little stuff, right? When people can say thank you. But we offend people when we don't smile and be loving, be gentle, and when we don't believe, to when we don't recognize their presence or speak or acknowledge or be grateful, or when we don't be humble. Because a lot of times the things we say out of our mouth, if we humbled ourselves, we could say them to a better way that they could be received and we won't offend. So offending others is usually unintentional and unknown. All of us offend others, but we are often unaware that we've offended people. You know how many people walking around right now mad at somebody that don't they know they mad at them? Because they said something or did something that didn't meet their approval. Now they upset rather than confronting. Because later on in Matthew, this 18th chapter, Jesus gives us an outline on Matthew's gospel, an outline as to how to deal with a brother who wrongs us or a sister who wrongs us. You initiate contact with the person first. If the person don't receive you, then you take a witness. If the witness is not clearly enough and the brother or sister still don't receive you, then you excommunicate them. That's what the Bible says. But we're standing around and try to win them and keep getting hurt, keep getting burnt, keep getting our butt to out the frame. Why? Because we think that's holy. And holiness ain't letting people ride you back. That's not true. Mm-mm. Holiness is not letting people ride you back. I wonder what Jesus was like, really. Because we got a watered down version of a man who was a revolutionary. And you don't revolutionize something in a peaceful setting. None of the freedom that we share has been to us. Jesus paid the price on Calvary. And before he went to Calvary, he was paying the price. So he paid the price for 3 years. Then he died on the cross. So there was a lot of hell going on for them to make to get that man at Jesus. Offenders. So we offend others as much as they offend us. We are as human as the next person. And we need forgiveness as much as the next person. Remembering this will do as much to maintain healthy relationships as possible. Could you, you know, I'm sorry goes a long way. Forgive me goes a long way. But let me say this to y'all. And I've noticed this, because people are asking for forgiveness, but they'll keep doing the same thing. Are they sorry? Let me say that again. People will ask you, you forgive people. They say, I'm sorry, you forgive them, but they turn around and do the same thing. Were they sorry the first time? Yeah, they were sorry. Sorry enough to do it again. Sorry enough to continue the trend. Not God, heartfelt apology, but they just want to get out the conversation or the circumstance right then. That part, 100%, absolutely. They keep doing the same thing over and over, and you expecting different results. Yo, we got to do better. The common response to being offended is to react, right? React by withdrawing, taking vengeance, or walling around in self-pity and in the spirit of unforgiveness. Many reveal in the attention secured by being the subject of abuse instead of handling the matter quietly in a true spirit of reconciliation. You have to get people off the hook. When I let you off the hook, I really let myself off the hook. Because when I let you off the hook, I'm not holding that what you've done over your head. When I let you off the hook, then I'm growing up. Salvation is about maturity. Paul said, when I was a child, I thought as a child. I acted as a child. I behaved as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. Now do we see through a glass dimly. See, y'all, forgiveness is just an unbelievable thing. Some of us got to go back and forgive our parents for some things they've done to us. Some of us got to give spouses or ex-spouses for things I've done for us. That don't mean we let them do it again. That just means you forgive them so that you can move on. Because watch this. A resentment only hurts me. So re means over and over and over. So what a resent means is a reenactment of what person did to hurt you that you haven't forgiven, happening over and over and over. I had a conversation with somebody about five or six years ago. And the conversation went like this. So you mean to tell me you've been divorced from this person for over 35, 40 years. And every time their name comes in your mouth, you don't have anything good to say. That person is dead and gone, but you're still holding a resentment. So they haunting you from the grave from what they did in 1970. The person said, I never saw it like that. I said, every time you don't forgive somebody, you just harbor resentment, and it plays over and over and over again. Every time you say that person's name, you get swole up. That friend is not hurting. Nah, Miss Valerie. Miss Valerie, you know better. Miss Valerie is my girl. Miss Valerie, you know better. Miss Valerie has known me since junior high school. So Miss Valerie and we share a very, very good relationship. As a matter of fact, her kids and I grew up together. No, Miss Valerie, don't let her in your space. Let me say this to you. In the act of forgiveness, once you forgive a person and you know they continue on that vein, just don't let them back in that space where they can hurt you again. Where they can do what they did again. Because people want forgiveness, but forgiveness and reconciliation holds two different realities. Right? That's right, cuz. So listen, an unforgiving spirit shows that a person is basically ill-natured. Huh? Self-centered and spiritually immature. Let me say that again. An unforgiving spirit shows basically that a person is ill-natured, self-centered, and spiritually immature. Don't nobody want to be any of those, right? You know, I just remember when somebody came on that I'm not asking for anything, but we have been having Bible study for 3 years. And we haven't taken any offering into. So I put Cash App in there for you to Cash App, all right, for Bible study. So listen, this unforgiving, immature, self-centered, spiritually bankrupt person, unforgiveness reveals that a person has not grown to be like Christ in his or her nature of understanding, of compassion, and of love. You know, when you think about it, love lifted all of us. When nothing else could help, love lifted us. And forgiveness is an act of compassion that restores a person to dignity. That's right. Don't let them live rent-free in your mind. That's right. So listen, this understanding and compassion and love, a forgiving spirit understands the nature of man and the nature of God. When we understand the nature of man is broken, therefore we restore him because we can't do anything to fix him or her. We restore him, but we keep moving. So peace and health can be preserved only through a forgiving spirit. An unforgiving spirit causes as much disturbance and division as the offender. An unforgiving spirit has stooped to the level of the offender. Watch this. You can't hold somebody down unless you get down there with them, or unless you stand in that same place you're holding them. I'm gonna leave that right there. You can't. You know, if you're holding somebody down, you got to stay right there with them. So who really is in the worst condition? You or the offender? You are, because now you've wasted your time trying to repay an individual. Y'all require that. The pastor does it all the time, because y'all say some stuff to the pastor that I wouldn't say to my child, as if I'm a child. People have offended me by telling me how to do my job, but if I came on your job and told you how to do your, and it's not a job, this is a vocation, comes from the Latin word vocare, which means to call out. So God called me and gave me this responsibility. I didn't ask for it like you asked for your job. I didn't ask for this. I promise you I didn't. So you know how offensive it is for somebody to tell me what they think I should be preaching, or how they think I should be responding, or how they think I, you know why? Because in their heart, they have malice and greed, and they stoop. I can't stoop to that level. Think. As long as there's an unforgiving spirit, there can never be peace. Disturbance, conflict, and division will always prevail. An unforgiving spirit also affects a person's emotions, mind, and body. When you're unforgiving, it affects your emotions, mind, and body. Think about it. When you see somebody that has wronged you and they coming, boy, your hands get sweaty. You stop thinking, I don't know what I'm going to say this. You know what I mean? And they might not even know they offended you. They coming. You preparing. Watch this. I'm going to tell you how childish adults are, but we want children to be adults. When somebody offends children, we just tell them, oh, don't worry about that. He ain't blah, blah, blah. Somebody offends children, don't worry about it. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me. Somebody feel children, get up, dust it off, and go back out there and play. They your friends. They didn't mean it. So why can't you do what you tell a child to do? If somebody offend you, why you just let them all do it? You know how many, you know, mama told me a long time ago. Mama said, listen, don't go around giving everybody a piece of your mind. You better save some for yourself. See, because unforgiveness will kill your brain, kills your spirit, kills your consciousness, kills your ability to move forward. Just let people off the hook and move on. Listen. An unforgiving spirit also, it not only affects our minds, bodies, and spirits, but it's the lack of peace that's created contextually from this unforgiveness. The lack of a good relationship with God and man that disturbs the normal functioning of the body, mind, and emotions. Do you know a lot of sicknesses are held because we're holding grudges and sickness? Did you know ulcers and high blood pressure are direct derivatives of unforgiving spirit, of harboring mess in our gut? Ooh, yeah. Ulcers, high blood pressure, disturbed thoughts and emotions, and on, all can, look, often do come through the spirit of unforgiveness. Man, I'm not going to let you worry me to death. And I need to say this. It took me a long time as a pastor to come to this as reality. So I know it takes time. So listen, forgiveness. There is God's spirit of forgiveness, right? He's just like a king who takes account of his servants. The parable is simple, yet very descriptive and full of meaning. God is the king, but he is a very unusual king. He is a king who rules justly, as all kings should. But he is more. He's loving, he's compassionate, he's caring, he's forgiving, and he's even more than that. He's consumed with love and compassion, so much so that he forgives enormous debts. Debts so enormous that they are inconceivable. Excuse me. Could you imagine the price that Christ paid on the cross to redeem our lives? Could you imagine the gift God gave and the price Christ paid? The gift God gave and the price Christ paid is enormous. So what level of discipline are you willing to foster to be in right relationship with yourself and with God? Because I really want to be in right relationship with myself, which is at peace, and with God, which is at peace. But once I establish that, I need to establish that horizontal relationship with my peoples. I don't want to walk around mad at everybody. I watch people driving in the street. You know, some of that old driving, I used to drive like a maniac. New York and D.C., I'm a maniac driver. No streets, no lines in the street, just going, zoom, zoom, zoom. And as I've matured, I've watched my behavior. Most of it was because the inside of me was speeding like the car. The inside of me was at peace, wasn't at peace. The inside of me was disturbed. So whatever I did outside was a reflection of what was really going on the inside of me. You know, this is a secretary job that we have in Christ. Stop acting like construction workers. So we always want to build up the outside of the building so it looks like the building sound, but when you get inside, ain't none of the paperwork done. All the floors are dirty. The toilet is messed up. The sink running. I mean, it's an inside job. It ain't about the bricks outside, what it looks like, what you look like in church. It's about how you act on Monday. I'm sorry. No, I'm not sorry. So listen, the king takes account of his servants. He takes account at varying times, right? And accounting is required at conversion and on those occasions when God leads us to evaluate ourselves. You know, before we take communion, the Bible tells us to let a man examine himself so he won't eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For if he does eat of that bread and drink of that cup unworthily, he should be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord, not discerning the Lord's body. So, and it says, for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. So you mean to tell me that I don't want to forgive somebody and I want to harbor all these feelings and I think I'm going to go to the communion table and eat? Said, no, you're guilty of that. And that's what I preach Sunday. We are Barabbas. Why? Because we always crucify Christ. Why? Because we confess him, we profess him, but we don't operate like him. So we kill him. You know what we kill? How we kill them? We kill them for people on our job who see how we act when we disturb. We kill them with our children when they see how we act at home. We kill them when we're dealing because we just always off balance. Balance. We kill them. That's why it says examine yourself. Because if you would be judged, let a man judge himself. Judge yourself. We know our, I know my stuff. I do. You know yours too. But are you willing to confess? Are you willing to deal with it? Are you willing to grow up? Listen. Note how the seven steps related by Christ can be applied to either of these times. All must give an account, right? The word reckon in that text means to take an account. I reckon that the glory of the present time can be revealed to all the glory that should be revealed in us. I reckon I give an account to make a reckoning, to settle an account. Okay? This is the same word that is translated, take account, in Matthew's 18 and 24, as we translate it from the original language. So the king began to check the province and the ledgers of his province, receipts and expenditures and the capital improvements. So the king had a critical interest in what his servants had received through gifts and what he had used in ministry. Listen, we are all brought to the king by the Spirit. You know, in our covenant, the Baptist Church covenant starts out with having been led as we believe to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized on the profession of our faith. The whole first statement of the Baptist covenant agrees contextually with the text that we need to be on one accord with Christ. But to do that, as we're forgiven, we must forgive others because we're led to this experience with Christ. So the Spirit of Christ will lead us through this experience if we allow it. How do we allow it? Through studying, through prayer, through worship, through consciousness, through obedience, through discipline. It's not an easy job. This is a hard job. It's hard to be a Christian. You know why? Because I've come to the table with preconceived notions of what it looks like and found out that those are all wrong, that I didn't need to look like the preacher. I need to look like Jesus. That I didn't need to act like the preacher. I need to act like Jesus. That I didn't need to walk around and be holy, but I needed to be holy as Jesus was. Holiness was just me submitting my righteousness into God so that through his righteousness, I become righteousness. Don't miss that. Not that I'm doing good makes me righteous, but I'm doing the will of God, and he accounts that as righteousness. That's what Romans says, right? Romans says that he accounts it as righteousness, okay? So listen, I'm willing. I'm going to do this last one because I hate to, but we are all brought to the king by the Spirit. So the word or some Christian witness, right? So somebody told us a story about the story, but it was through the Spirit that we came to the knowledge of Christ. We heard the story. It pricked our consciousness. That's why I read all of that stuff. Through the pricking of our consciousness, we became willing participants in the process of this new life. Okay? We are led to see our huge debt of sin and service that we owe God. See, the debt of the servant was huge in the text. It was millions of dollars. It was probably the gross revenues of a province or a state in that day. The servant was the high official placed over the province who was held responsible for its administration. The point is that God has given us life and made us overseers responsible for that life. To sin is to mismanage that life and to cause loss. Therefore, sin puts us in debt to God. Right? Watch this. I'm shaping it up now. So the debt is infinite and beyond anything that we can ever repay. So we are all bankrupt, unable to pay before God. Sin bankrupts a man and put him or woman in debt to God. We are all so bankrupt by sin that nothing can pay our debt. Silver and gold, no amount, neither brother, good works, making sacrifice, giving money, working in the church, nothing can repay the debt of love that we owe. Note that the man's debts affected his family. His enslavement and loss would have meant their enslavement and loss. A man's sin always affects both him and his family. So we face the justice of a just God. We cry for mercy. Our only hope is that God loves us enough that he will simply forgive us in compassion and have mercy on our lives. We hear the love and forgiveness of a loving God. So let me leave you with these two thoughts. Some of the things that bring us to God and cause us to evaluate and take account of our lives, our trials and troubles and sicknesses and diseases, a sermon, a witness, a tragedy, a parent, a friend, or some special thing are really good for us. So anything that brings you to your knees is good for you. Before, mama used to say, boy, before you get on your feet, you're going to have to get on your knees. And see, that's what we have to realize. Let's move everything back to a child. Before a child can walk, it learns to crawl. And even in crawling, it moves a few steps forward. It backs up a few steps. It moves a few steps forward. It backs up a few steps. When it stops walking, it just stands up and stands still. And when it starts standing still, then it wobbles a little. See, y'all, this is how our lives as Christians. Are you walking or are you still crawling? Are you walking or are you still crawling? See, note that the false servant had cried out for mercy until he was brought face to face with the king. We're often careless about sin until we are called to account. You don't care what you do and somebody bring it to your attention. You don't even know it's what you're doing. Until somebody say, I don't appreciate that, or I don't like that. How fewer trials and sufferings and temptations would we face if we turn from sin immediately? Oh, a lot of what we go through is brought upon us by us. Not a lot of it, all of it. And then God uses it to develop us only if we let him. The word of God for the people of God. And the people said, thanks be to God. Are there any questions, comments? Questions, comments? All right. I'm not going to hold you. Let's pray. Hey, Teresa. We're going to continue to pray for Deacon Walker. Good to see Teresa King Miller on the phone. She's been going through her own set of challenges. You're welcome, Adela. Thank you, too. Our own set of challenges Teresa's been going through. And remember, Teresa's the caregiver of Jay. So not only is she caring for Jay, but she's now having to care for herself. She's been in this place for a while. Teresa, we keep you in our prayers. We love you. And Sammy's there trying to help. So y'all just keep that King Miller family. It seems like they're just going through a series of challenges right now. Thank you, Patricia. Let every head be bowed and every eye closed. Most gracious and eternal God, our Father, in your presence is the fullness of joy. Tonight in our study, we experience your presence. because your presence is profoundly understated in your word. But your word tells us that in the beginning, you were the word. So thank us. We thank you tonight for inviting us into a deeper appreciation of the relationship that you offer us. We pray tonight that each person under the sound of my voice receive what it was that you had to say, and that we can move on and mature as you require. We pray for those who are sick amongst us. We pray for those who are caring for the sick. We pray for those who are loving and caring on elderly parents. God, what a great challenge to be a caregiver to someone who wants care for you. God, please give us the strength and the knowledge and the provisions we need to do what it is that you require to help facilitate a calming life for them, God, as they're challenged with age. God, we pray for our children, but most of all, we pray for the parents of those children. God, bless those parents to at least give the children a chance at a second look at life. All they see in the world is crime and corruption and all the things, God, that are separating them from you. Help the parents, God, to at least give their kids an opportunity at seeing the other world. God, we know you're able to do it exceedingly and abundantly above all we ask or think. So we want to ask your forgiveness and restoration that our prayers not go in vain. God, we love you for having chosen us out of darkness, but we need you to teach us how to represent your light. Continue to bless First Calvary as a whole. Strengthen her and keep her. Use her to your glory for your will and purpose for its establishment. Thank you, God. This is your servant's prayer. Receive now, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hey, Lisa. Listen, thank y'all for showing up tonight. If nobody told you, God loves you, and so do I, and there's nothing you could do about it. Powerful lesson. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, God, for using it. Okay, God bless you. God bless you. Cash App, $1SS. Hey, Juan, thank you, Pastor. You're welcome. You're welcome. Miss Valerie, it's always good to see you, sweetie. Always. Thank you. I appreciate that. All right. I said all I know. It's time to go. God bless you and good night.